There's a reason why I wanted to do this song this week. Because it's about false, I want to talk about false gods. You know, it's been our fundamental thing with the children of Israel the last year, right? That's their big problem.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah. They keep getting into trouble because of false gods. So the idea with the words of that song was kind of to be a review of some of the things that happened between Solomon, where the false gods were introduced by his wives, to the point now where they've fallen into captivity. So we're used to seeing in these stories pictures of false gods. You know, we have Jeroboam's golden calves. We've had, you remember this guy? Dagon, the Philistine god, false god there. Baal, he's our false god number one. These are the best pictures we could find of some Baal statues. But I want to give you a story today. It's in the New Testament. And the false god isn't like those. So see if you can listen to the story and find the false god in the story.
I think the adults will have no problem with this. I'm curious if you boys can pick this up.
Here we go. It was the Sabbath day of rest. Jesus and his disciples were traveling through some fields of grain. The disciples were hungry and began to pick some heads of grain, rub them in their hands, and eat the kernels. When the Pharisees saw this, they said to Jesus, "Look, your disciples are breaking the law by working on the Sabbath." They were accusing the disciples of harvesting the grain by rubbing it in their hands. Jesus replied, "When King David and his companions were hungry, they entered the house of God, and they broke the law by eating the consecrated bread. Something greater than the temple is here. If you only understood what God meant when he said, 'I desire mercy, not sacrifice,' you would not be accusing the innocent. The Son of Man is the Lord of the Sabbath." On another Sabbath, day of rest, Jesus went into a synagogue to teach. The synagogue is like a church. A man was there whose right hand was withered. The Pharisees and the teachers of the law were looking closely to see if Jesus would heal on the Sabbath. Jesus knew what they were thinking and said to the man with the withered hand, "Get up and stand in front of everyone." So the man stood up. Looking for a reason to accuse Jesus of doing wrong, they asked, "Is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath?" Jesus replied, "If any of you has sheep and it falls into a pit on the Sabbath, would you not take hold of it and lift it out?" You get why he's asking that? Getting the sheep out would be work. And they're saying, "Don't do any work." So he's like, well, you get your sheep out, right? Jesus continued, "How much more valuable is a person than a sheep? Which is more lawful on the Sabbath, to do good or to do evil, to save a life or destroy it? You don't break the law by doing good on the Sabbath." And when he says the law, he's talking about Moses' law, the Ten Commandments. So he looked around at them all and he said to the man, "Stretch out your hand." He did so, and his hand was completely healed. But the Pharisees and the teachers of the law were furious and began to plot what they might do to Jesus. So there was no statue in that story, right? No.
Where's my false god that I brought today? You know?
Nobody's kneeling down and worshiping a false god. "Oh, mighty and powerful gargoyle, please bring rain. You know, oh, mighty and powerful gargoyle, please heal this man's hand." Nobody did that. But there's a false god in this story. Did you pick it up? Can you imagine what a false god in this story would be? You're on the right track. You're on the right track. So, what is it? I mean, you think about what is a false god. You know, if you have, if we, this is what, just some sort of a plaster or something. I don't know what it's made of. But is it real?
No.
I mean,
it's not alive,
right? So I can ask it for the winning lottery numbers. I could ask it for better haircut. I could ask it for all sorts of things. Is it going to give me any of these things? But isn't this what those people in these stories did? They worship Baal. They would go to Baal, which is just a wooden pole or a figurine, and say, Baal, give us rain. Give us fire. So what were they doing there? They kind of just lying to themselves. Right? Because you can ask this statue 1,000 times for anything. And the answer is always the same. Nothing. It's nothing will happen. So they lie to themselves. They make something that's not real. And in their minds, they make it real. That's what a false god is. They're protecting something that they've made up. So, in our story, what did they make up? They took the commandments too seriously. You're right. Absolutely right. Why did they do that? What was important to them? What were they making real, trying to make real in their life, that wasn't by doing that? Who's in control?
You.
Yeah. Okay. What were they trying to do to Jesus?
Be in control.
Right. How were they trying to be in control? By using the commandments as a weapon. Right? They were trying to keep power. Pharisees, they were the leaders. They were trying to keep in control of everybody else. So what's their false god? They were kind of making power a false god. They were almost making God a false god. Yeah? Because they were giving the people an idea of what God wanted. That was false. They were creating the Lord and distorting and twisting what he wanted into something that they could use to keep power over other people. This is a false god in this story. It's this desire for power and control and a belief that they could actually have that control. Because, if I tell Matthew, well, look, the only way you're going to get to heaven is by giving me $5 every time you come to church. And Matthew, he's a nice boy. He comes to church every Sunday, and he says, all right, here, Todd, you go. I want to go to heaven. Is that real?
No.
No. When Matthew wakes up and the angels tell him, well, Matthew says, I give $5 every week to Todd. Where's my place in heaven? The angels are going to say, He told you wrong. It's a false Todd in that case. But so there are false gods that happen, and this is these stories that we have, they happen so many times over and over and over in the Bible about these false gods. And the Lord knows, the Lord knew how this world was going to be. This wasn't a surprise to him that people are no longer worshiping statues. But he gave us these stories because, well, what happens? People do like this and they worship false gods that aren't statues, but they believe in their own power. They believe in they're so smart that they can outsmart everybody else and even outsmart the Lord. You know, they think that, oh, well, if I just have lots of money, so that's an easy false god. Oh, if I have lots of money, I'll have everything I need and I'll be happy. They make all sorts of things false gods. So we have the God who's healed in the story is the man with the withered hand. And if you want to look at your order of service, you may see some readings here. It's about this Secrets of Heaven 878. It says the hand corresponds to power. The hand means power. And Matthew had a good demonstration of that. How was I controlling you? With my hands, right? Yeah. I was holding your hands. So I was limiting your power with my hands. The hands represent power. This is how correspondences work. There's always a reason behind it. And you can see that third paragraph there. Here, hand clearly stands for his own power, so a person's own power, which he attributed to what he had done. So we think about, oh, look at how powerful I am, look at the things that I do. You do it with your hands, whether you create Minecraft palaces with your hands, or you create science projects with your hands, you go out into the yard, you build a fort with your hands. The Lord's telling us that these are the things we attribute to ourselves, but we're supposed to be giving credit to the Lord for the things that we do. Says the next one, it is to truth especially that power is attributed from the word, and so it is truth to which the hands, the arms, the shoulders have reference. So a spiritual power is the things we find in the word. So if the word is withered, it's because there's no truth in it. So if somebody has taken it like the Pharisees did in the story, and they corrupted it. They made a big deal out of the commandments that they weren't supposed to do. Secrets of Heaven, the next one is the 49, 32, and 33. You guys remember at camp, there was the fractal box you built up?
Oh, yeah.
All right, and the idea is you had one little box, but then it became a repeating pattern. So if you look back, from a distance, it looked like one box. But that up close, it was also just one box. Well, what Swedenborg describes is something called the grand man. So he looks at you, he sees a man, person. He looks around, sees a person. But if the Lord steps back and looks at the entire earth, he looks at it and he sees a person. And so we're talking about here, it says the ones who in the grand man correspond to the hands and arms, and also the shoulders, are those with power received through the truth of faith grounded in good. For those who have received the truth of faith are grounded in good, have received power from the Lord. They attribute all their power to him and none to themselves. And the more they attribute no power to themselves, doing so not with their lips but with their heart, the greater power they have. This is why angels are called powers and authorities. The reason why hands, arms, and shoulders correspond to power in the grand man is that the strength and powers of the whole body and of all its internal organs are linked to them, and that the body employs the arms and hands to exercise its strengths and powers. This is also the reason why the word powers are meant by the hands, the arms, and the shoulders. So do you get the idea that when we say something corresponds to something else, there's a reason for it. It's not an accident. The hands meaning power, the shoulders meaning power, the arms about power. It's because you think something and it comes through from your arm. You think about building something on the Xbox and it comes through your hands. That's where your power lies, right? The power of the word lies in its ability to change what's happening up here. And so if this man has a withered hand, he has no power. Who did he seek out to heal him? The Lord, right? So he seeks out the Lord. He says, okay, help me have some power in my life. And he does this, he gets this hand healed by rejecting the false gods that the Pharisees were giving him. He says, you guys give me all this nonsense. He goes directly to the Lord. He doesn't ask somebody else about the Lord. He goes directly to the Lord. And this is why we keep saying, go and read the word for yourself. As you get older, it's more important to read the word for yourself. Ask the Lord directly, just like King David did, while he was the best. He asked the Lord directly every time, how do I get this done? The Lord answered him. Because he wants to have power. David had power. This guy didn't. So, it's just a short little story about how the Lord can heal all sorts of things. But try to use this lesson of seeing false gods in the world. Look out for us when somebody makes something so terribly important that there's nothing more important to it, but this thing, whatever it is, isn't actually important. Because that's what people do. They make something that's unimportant, important, and they make a big deal about it. They try to bring you along to worship that false god with them. Okay? Amen. And I think I'm going to invite you guys to join me in a prayer. Lord, help us see that there are lots of people out there that mean well, but sometimes lead us towards false gods. Help us come to you directly to make the healings and the changes we need in our life. Our Father, who art in the heavens, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, as in heaven, so upon the earth. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also forgive our debtors. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. The kingdom and the power and the glory forever.
Die Ed will do the benediction and close the word. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with us all. Amen.
Daniel's going to come up and do a song for us.
Before I play this song, I just want to thank you all for welcoming us here. The last year, we're heading off on a world trip on Tuesday. We're going to be away for about at least a year. So thank you so much, everyone, for having us. We'll see you when we get back. This song's called "Break My Heart," and it's about taking responsibility for your life. Oh, baby, break my heart.
Thank you very much. Thanks, everyone.
Very hot. Yeah. Dan was on that. The drawing that someone had to look at last year, he said, oh, it needed gas, and he's got a gas leak, and he's not, still not working, and he said, it can't be fixed, and he had an additional $500. Somebody said that gas can't get out, the seal, and
Jesse. Yeah, that's fine. But anyway, I mean, she
You can go with the flow and say, I think they She's going to be super well. She's really growing. And Audrey's going to ask her then. She's going to be like, hey, so why is that?
As long as it's
if she's going to be here, I'll tell you that. I'm going to be so excited. I'm going to be like, yeah.